All right, so I'm honored to welcome, I have to find my copy of the book to replace my face with it. Welcome Alysia Sawchyn to the chat this evening. She is the author of the essay collection of Fish Growing Lungs. And Alysia, could you just please tell us a little bit more about yourself?
Yeah, sure. I actually live in the DC area. I live in Arlington, and I sort of hodgepodge my living between teaching at the University of Maryland and doing some tech writing and teaching online at Catapult. And I'm also a features editor for The Rumpus, and Fish is my first book, which is very exciting. And she's a Gemini, so that's good.
I'm very excited too that you shortened the name of the book to Fish. That is very endearing. And also, this is now the live from Arlington version of Writer Center, because I'm also up on Highway 29. So welcome to Arlington, everyone. So could you give us just a brief reading to give everyone who maybe hasn't had a chance to read the work yet a sample of what they can expect from your book and what we're going to be talking about?
Yeah, sure. So I am going to read the first few paragraphs of a chapter called Go Ask Alice. I don't know if any of you remember that like really horribly traumatizing anonymous book from like health class, but anyway. The epigraph for this is at least once you should live with someone more medicated than yourself, and it's from Bob Hickok's poem Bottom of the Ocean. Alice kept a shoebox full of pills in her closet, and there were still more orange bottles lined up on her bathroom sink. Every morning and night, her phone pinged with medication reminders, offering convenient checkboxes to keep track of it all. Sometimes she forgot to mark off the doses, or did she? She was never sure. And those were the watching days. We met at the start of grad school, orientation as a predictable gray sludge of complicated policies that would be half-heartedly enforced, and painful icebreakers, two truths and one lie, orchestrated by earnest-faced model students. Alice and I were foils that day. I talked too much, she said almost nothing. After 8 hours together at a small round table, I'd learned only that she preferred Earl Grey tea and planned to attend the optional session the next day. So it wasn't a surprise the following afternoon when, as I entered the large auditorium, I saw Alice curl up in a chair close to the stage. It was impossible to feign not noticing her, and I sat down. Either I'd arrived close to the assembly's beginning, or I'd mercifully forgotten what awkward, stilted conversation we shared in waiting. But what happened next is important. The speaker was terrible, and so instead of listening or even pretending to listen, I studied Alice. I took in her rainbowed leopard print backpack, her small feet, the slip-on shoes she'd wedged underneath her chair, the thin script tattoos on her wrists, pale, pale scars tracked up the inside of her left arm that matched those on my right. Though she doesn't remember this, Alice later told me it was our mutual love of strong, dark tea that suggested to her we would be friends. For me, it was the scars. When the speaker announced we'd be moving into capital B breakout sessions according to our research interests and resource concerns, Alice and I looked at one another and agreed to slip out while everyone else was regrouping. We walked across the red-bricked campus slowly, feeling sticky in the August afternoon. And then we get snow cones and make fun of people.
I wish that was the very end of the story, but all your stories end with getting snow cones and making fun of people. So let's start broadly. What's the strength of personal essay as a genre and as a form? And what does it allow you to do that's unique compared to a term I'm coining right now, impersonal essay or fiction?
So I've been thinking a lot about this. and I think it does many things, but I think one of the things that I like about it the most that it does is it just completely gets rid of the myth of objectivity, which non-personal nonfiction is also equally subjective. It just puts on an objective jacket and then it goes outside of the house. And the personal essay just doesn't put on that jacket. And I think that's one of the things that is really remarkable about the form, and also like how much it offers in terms of interiority. I think that the essay in general just allows a writer to talk a lot more and unwind thoughts in a way that traditional, air quotes, like fiction won't, for example, and things of that nature. So yeah, I'm a babbler by nature, and I like to be able to do, I like, the form is gonna let me do it, cool, like there I am, this is mine.
Are there any people in personal essay, or any authors of personal essay right now that you're particularly keen on?
All of them. This is funny. Anytime someone asks me for book recommendations, I forget every single book I've ever read. And I'm reading predominantly like micros right now because I'm working on my next book project. So like right now, for instance, I'm reading Children of the Land, which is by a poet. He's actually a poet by training, but this is like this beautiful memoir. But it's micros, and I love it so much. Do you also have a copy?
I have a copy of his poetry collection directly behind me. So we're, my story collection was published with BOA. So we met at our table once, but yes. He's fantastic.
Yeah, and he's also like a wonderful human, right? Which is always a good thing, I think. That's what I'm reading right now. And then some other essayists I love, just like off the top of my head. I love Yula Biss like so much. Like thinking, and I think she does some like really interesting work thinking about like what it means to write like a personal essay versus an impersonal essay. Like her her book on immunity, for example, is really heavily researched. And then she just sort of appears in there as like these little like boop, boop, boop moments. And it makes me think too about like, you know, most bookstores you walk into, if you want to get, this is my experience anyway, most bookstores I walk into, if I want a creative nonfiction book, I have no idea where this thing is going to be. Like some very, maybe one or two stores I found have an actual like memoir section, but usually it's like an autobiography section. So like I've ended up in like cooking, you know, and like music or like self-help, but I'm like, can we just like, I want my bookshelf in a section on the store. That's what I'm saying. Sorry, I just totally got off track there.
You're planning to open a bookstore.
You know, in this economy, I don't know, but someday, maybe. Also, speaking of food, MFK Fisher is another writer who I really love. And I don't, you know, she wrote pretty much extensively about food, but it's personal essay, like 100%. So those are just a couple people off the top of my head.
You said the food, but writing about food, but personal essay, and just your previous comments, I was also thinking of Hanif Abdurraqib, who's often writing about music, but then it's like this amazing, like, I've never read a lot of, I've obviously read some personal essays, but I never dived into the form, but I read, what's the name of his collection?
The one with the wolf on it?
Yes.
Yeah, that one. Mm-hmm.
Well, Emily, could you find Hanif Abdurraqib's collection and post
it's
that
like
in the chat?
It's like on my bookshelf. I want to go get it so bad to be like, this is the title. They
it's
can't kill us until they kill us.
On the other side right here. So I can't get
to it until they kill us.
Yeah. Oh, that's it. Thank you.
Yeah.
But anyway, that's great. So just being honest, the opposite side of what are the strengths of personal essay, what limitations does that put on you as an author when you're writing personal essay?
I'm gonna climb on my little soapbox for a moment and say, it is the perception of what personal essay is that is the true limitation. I think that, so, you know, I taught creative writing to undergrads, and a lot of times undergrads come in and they're like, essay, ew, because they think they're like having a comp flashback, basically, which like I have a master's in rhetoric and composition. So just to be clear, I'm not knocking that kind of essay. But that's what a lot of people think when they hear the term essay. Alternatively, they think like the Dear Jane, like my horrible Lifetime movie, I got paid 50 bucks for this type of story. And I don't really think it, you know, not both of those are incredibly limiting definitions. And, you know, John DeGatta, like, you know, is like, does it even have to be true? So, you know, in terms of what a personal essay can be, I think the definitions are, I don't think we have a good definition for like what it is at this point, which I, you know, I'm okay with, but I do think that it's definitely like not marketable. I don't know. I guess when people are like, oh, you write, what do you write? And like, I don't write memoir, but like, if I say memoir, I feel like people have a better understanding of what I'm writing about than if I say like, I write personal essay.
So Emily just posted the most important link that I forgot to mention, which is the link to buy Alysia's book at Borough Press. You can also order it from your local independent bookstore, but absolutely buy this book. It's great. I was lucky to have read it fairly early on. And I also made a note about your first answer that I forgot to bring up, which I think we have a new motto for the Writer Center, which is destroying the myth of objectivity. It's the new Writer Center motto. It's going on our business cards. It's going on our letterhead. That's what we do. Yeah. Do you write in other genres? Do you plan to stick with personal essay and creative nonfiction, or do you branch out in other directions too?
I actually got my start writing fiction just because like, that's what was available at my university in terms of courses. I do write poetry. I dabble poetry. I haven't really seriously written fiction since I've gone to graduate school, if I'm being honest. I don't know if I'll return to it. I read so many novels that I probably read more fiction than I do nonfiction, but I'm just not particularly drawn to writing it anymore. But I do write poetry here and there. But like, I think with poetry, it's like, I know just enough to know that I'm like, do I really want other people to see this? I don't know.
I published one poem in like 2009, I want to say, and that was my claim to being a poet. So I should also mention that you and I talked virtually via email for an interview, which will be in the next issue of the Writer Center magazine when it comes out in just a few weeks. So some of these questions, I just stole them from that instead of making up new questions for this talk. But one of the things that I was interested in was the particular subject. Because I don't want to talk about the subject so much as the approach from a craft perspective of how you address this subject. And one thing I've been reading a lot about for a project I'm working on is illness narratives and how it's common to find the triumph story in which a person becomes ill, receives treatment, and gets better, and then usually earns some new wisdom or strength along the way. I see a much more complex approach to the illness narrative in your work. And I guess my question initially was, do you resist pat endings, and how do you feel about that whole idea of the narrative with the clean, clear cut, I won't say happy, but satisfying ending?
So I mentioned just a few minutes ago that I have a master's in rhetoric and composition. And so the reason I bring this up again is because, you know, sometimes thinking about like, how long did it take you to write this book? So before I did my MFA, that master's program, my work focused on working with mental health organizations. So like even before I got to the part where like I started writing, I spent a couple of years like studying like mental health populations from like the other side, from like the scholar's perspective or whatever. And so that included like a fair amount of work into like disability studies and like illness narratives specifically. So I came into the writing process having already read a lot of theory about that and being like, I hate all of this so much. Which, you know, I think I always end up talking about like marketing and capitalism, which I don't like to do. But like, I guess for me, the only times I really wanted to like write this nice like ooh, were the times where I was like, screw this. I'm just gonna write a novel. That's my life, but it's gonna be called a novel. Or when I was like, you know what? I'm gonna write some New York Times, like, you know, great, just compelling The Glass Castle 2.0. Those are really the only times that I thought that. Other than that, I kind of always knew that I wanted it to be essentially what it is, which is like this ungainly creature that looks at misdiagnosis from like a bunch of different perspectives and doesn't really come out, say, like come down to like a firm landing at the end. It's just like, it's different. And in the answer I gave you via email, you know, I talk about change being like, instead of an arc, instead of that, it's like just the idea of change. So it's just something looks different by the time you get to the end. And so that's just how I think about it. Cause the part of the reason that I think I've been so invested in nonfiction is just because, like, I don't know, it matters to me that, like, it's true as it can be. And I think, like, the more you get into, like, a narrative, I don't know, my memory's just, like, A, my memory's just super bad, and B, like, with all art, there is omission, but I feel like with the curve, you're shaping, or at least in my experience, it's getting shaped a lot more than it is in, like, say, a fish, where it's just kind of, well.
Just a reminder to all our attendees, please put your questions into the chat box. If you can find that by hovering your mouse over the bottom of the screen, click the chat button and just type in all your questions. I feel like there should be some good ones after all the things we've talked about. So speaking of the shape of the narrative though, do you ever feel pressured from editors, from unnamed external forces to turn the stories into something with the traditional, you know, story arc shape?
No. I love my editor. He's wonderful. Borough Press is just, they're really great. And part of the reason why I wanted to go with a small press is because, like, I have control issues, unsurprisingly, maybe. And I just, like, I didn't want the giant machine that is publishing to, like, take my thing and turn it into something that I didn't want it to be, which, like, you know, doesn't always happen, but I don't know, for whatever reason, I've always kind of wanted to be like this, and my editor was, like, really lovely and preserving it that way. And before that, when I was, like, drafting, and this was originally, like, my thesis from my MFA program, and same thing, my director has written a number of essay collections, and yeah, just from the beginning, he was like, yeah, you want to be an essay collection? Cool, like, just go ahead, write stuff. You're going to change it later anyway, you know, just, and was very process-oriented, so.
We have our first question coming in. So how accurate do you have to be in personal essay? Do you need to verify the facts in your narrative? And how much do you need to verify them? And when do you need to verify and change names?
It's funny. I think it depends who you ask. You know, there's definitely people who, like, there's definitely people who don't believe that things have to be true. There are people who fact check really hard. I think, like, the advice that I've always given is, like, finding what you are comfortable with, and also at the same time recognizing that, like, what you're comfortable with might change in the future. So, like, one example of this, and, like, hopefully they're not listening right now, but one example of this is I was writing something, this has not been published, but I was writing something about one of my exes, and about my ex's mother specifically. And, you know, it was one of those things where, like, at the time, I felt, like, really justified in writing it, and I had this little thing, and then, like, this small voice in my head was, like, in the future, will you regret this, possibly? And that small voice, and I was, like, you know what, I'm just gonna put this away, and I'm gonna think about this, and I'm gonna come back to it later. So, I guess that's sort of my guiding principle. I fact check myself a fair amount. And by a fair amount, I mean, I do fact check myself. It's part of my writing process. And part of the fun thing for me about writing personal essay is, like, the writing often can become part of the process. Like, the research of it is sometimes, like, part of the essay and where it ends up going. I got all my old medical records. I'm actually, like, writing a piece on, for Brevity's blog about that. Because, yeah, I did a bunch of research just in my own past, fact-checking myself. But in terms of stuff like changing people's names, and, I mean, if you open most nonfiction books, memoir at this point, it'll say things like, some names have been changed and identifying details to protect privacy. I definitely like cut stuff out that would make people more identifiable. I didn't change anything in mine personally because like I didn't want to. My personal thing is like, if I'm making something up, I try to make it clear that I'm making something up. So like Three Men, for example, like that is three characters turned into one character. And I try to be like, hey, this is what I'm doing, guys. Cause I didn't want to put any of those single people like unflesh their whole thing in a chapter. Yes, that was my very long-winded answer.
Oh, that's great. So I'm of a certain age, but I still, whenever I read the certain names have been changed, I always hear it in the same voice that was at the beginning of sitcoms. It said, Cheers was filmed in front of a live studio audience. That's like what I hear it as whenever it comes up. So so you touched on this a little bit, I think, but this essay collection addresses experiences that by their very nature resist remembering. And how do you approach writing about blurry or fragmented memories? How do you fact check? How do you do those processes you talked about when the memory itself has just been corrupted by time?
part of it is, you know, as I mentioned, like tipping my hand and being clear when it's like, I think maybe this happened. I hope this is what happened. But other times, you know, it is a question of like making uncomfortable phone calls, for example. Or, I mean, some of it is also like the structural choices I make. So for example, the Cliff Face essay, it's like about hiking Old Rag, and it's also about doing cocaine. And I, you know, it would be very hard for me to write like a beginning, middle, end essay about doing cocaine that was like really satisfying, because like, it's just not, I don't know, that just wasn't my experience. And so part of it is like using form in such a way that I can, you know, craft an experience for the reader that still gets them where I want them to be without having to like fudge a narrative, basically.
So you mentioned that, moving on to my miscellaneous category here, you mentioned that you're also an editor for The Rumpus.
Yeah.
So how does your editorial practice influence your writing, and what have you learned as a writer from being an editor?
So one of the things I love the most about working with The Rumpus is that we take essays, and then like the editors will oftentimes like work quite a bit with the writers in revisions, which is different than any of my previous editing experiences, which I really enjoy that. And so part of it is just like, you know, my work is not as precious as I think it is. And, you know, being willing to like accept change and that other people have good ideas. And that I've always been a very slow writer, both in terms of like getting words onto the page, but then also I need to like step away for a long time before I'm able to look at something again and be able to like literally reconceptualize it. I think The Rumpus is just kind of, working for The Rumpus and editing for them has just sort of like reinforced all of that, which I think is healthy, you know, and building like a thicker skin. I've worked in lit mags for a while. And so it's just really helped me like build a thicker skin in terms of like getting rejections and stuff. Like it's not personal, even though it often feels like I'm dying inside.
I'll say that I have, I think I've only once outright rejected edits from an editor. And in that case, I was wrong. Definitely wrong. And there's only one time out of all the edits that I've accepted where I actually look back still and regret that I accepted an edit.
Yeah.
And I was too, like, most editors are absolutely cool. Like, and I don't always do exactly what an editor says when they suggest edits, but I almost always recognize that their edits identified something. And it's not necessarily changing that sentence. Sometimes it's looking back and realizing something. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. But yeah, so I love the editorial process. And I when you said not being precious about your work, and I think I learned that, and only once has it betrayed me. One sentence that I wish I had back in my first book. I'll live with it. I'm gonna just tape it in my copy so I know it's there. So we had a couple questions come in. Let me scroll back up real quick. And I really like this one. How do you handle writing about a memory that is almost certainly held in a different point of view by others involved? To me, that also sort of implies, how do you consider the experience of someone else in some true story you're telling?
Yeah, I think this question or some iteration of it gets asked in like every single nonfiction talk, you know, because it's just such like a, like it's such a concern for everybody writing nonfiction. And like for me, I take it by a case, on a case by case basis. Like I would love to tell you I have a blanket policy, but I don't. It's highly contextual based on my relationship with that person. So yeah, I would really love to like have a really helpful answer. But so for example, we can talk about three men. I feel like that's a good example. So there are obviously three men involved in that essay. And one of them I interviewed specifically for writing this essay, and did so with his permission. So I was like, hey, I'm writing an essay about this. I would like to interview you. So like the direct quotes are like actually sitting on the bed, you know, me with a like pencil, whatever. And he got to read it before I ended up like, you know, submitting it anywhere, et cetera. The other two people, I did not get in touch with them about it. Have I been in touch with one of them? Anyway, the point is that with one of them, it just felt weird, especially because I combined the characters. And for the other one, I just had no desire to contact them. And so it goes, you know, there's this book that the title now escapes me, but it's an anthology, and I know that somebody on here knows what it's called. But it's essentially like a book, an anthology of essays about writing about other people. And Jill Christman has an essay in there called Chewing Band-Aids. And the takeaway is basically like, you have no idea what people are gonna be upset about. Like you think you know, and then you're wrong. I really thought my parents would be upset about some stuff, and they were not. And I was very pleasantly surprised by that. So I just case by case. And like with my parents, I gave them a copy of the manuscript when I found out it would be published for them to read in advance. And they didn't read it until, I don't think my dad has actually finished reading it still. I'll be really honest with you. Oh, you are the best, Melissa. The anthology is called Family Trouble and it's edited by Joy Castro. So I just, you know, I do it by case by case basis. I think for me, like one of the things that was important is being like clear. So for example, like when I gave the manuscript to my parents, it was not like, if you don't like something, tell me and I'll change it. Because that was not how I felt about it when I gave it to them. It was very much like, this is getting published, here you go. And so for me, like being clear about things, whereas like when I interviewed that guy, I was like, hey, like, let's have a conversation about this, because that was how I felt about that particular person in telling that story. So I think it's very context-based, but I try to be like really direct and clear with people about it.
So the next question I'm gonna look at is a kind of specific, and I'm gonna follow up myself with a broader version of that question. So which publications would you suggest I submit one of my essays describing the lens of hope I have found through the full recovery from a suicide attempt in 2015? And then what are, my question is, what are the personal essay publications that you think are particularly kicking butt right now in terms of publishing really great work?
Yeah. I guess it's hard to answer the first question, mostly because I think you can approach that topic from so many different perspectives that I don't think I can actually answer that, right? Because like, for example, like, Black Warrior Review takes really experimental work. So like, if you have this really experimental essay, I'm gonna be like, send it there. But if it's like a narrative, I'd be like, send it to the Sun. So, you know, I guess for me, like style and content are both, I don't know. So I can't answer the first part of that question. I'm sorry. But just in terms of like great lit journals and places that publish, I love Catapult. I think they publish like really great stuff, and they do it with stunning regularity as well. There are just a couple columns on there that I like love, all of which the names escape me, of course. Happily, oh my God, the Paris Review has had some like gems recently. The column Happily is in the Paris Review. Fourth genre, but of course. Also River Teeth, also The Sun. Those are, for me, are the big ones. I'm sure I'm like forgetting one and I'm gonna kick myself later, but off the top of my head, those are the sort of big ones. I mean, obviously The Rumpus, but like, you know.
I'll say too that, I mean, one of the big things about submitting anywhere too is these places receive thousands of submissions.
Oh yeah.
And so when you're submitting, make sure you're bringing your very best work, and also recognize that if someone says no, it doesn't necessarily reflect on the work that you're submitting. It's just an issue of it's large numbers, and the percentages of acceptances are tiny. For so many, especially prominent journals, it's less than 1%. So it doesn't mean they didn't like your work. It just means they only have so much space to publish work, and yours wasn't in this tiny little bit that they personally, subjectively liked enough to include in their journal. So trying to get published with short fiction, with essays and poetry can be a slog. And sometimes the only way to deal with it is to submit to a lot of places. But first thing you do is make sure that your work is absolutely on point, because you're entering really, really crowded area. So make sure you're ready for that.
Yeah. And you know, it's funny you mentioned those like really narrow margins. Like I remember when I was getting my MFA, so creative writing faculty talking about like the other faculty in the English department just like not being able to conceive how hard it was to get published in some of these journals. Cause like with a scholarly peer reviewed journal, like it's prestigious, right? It's an acceptance rate of like 20% or something. And they're like, no, this is like under 1%. And people are like, did you leave a zero off of that? And they're like, no, it's literally under 1%. It's just, I feel like it's just hard to conceptualize until like literally you open your inbox and you're like, oh God, I have to read all of this.
Next question from our attendees. You mentioned your retcomp mental health writing serving as a background for your essays in this collection. So when you incorporate research material in a personal essay, do you tend to seek out that research material for an essay you have begun, or do you find that outside material helps to create an essay?
I guess it's kind of like a chicken and egg question. And yeah, I think it depends on the essay, because there's definitely been stuff where I'm like, that's so cool, let me write an essay about it. A very recent example, did you know that magnolias are older than bees, which is why they look so friggin' weird, because beetles were how they got pollinated. So it's why they have those like incredibly fat pistils, stamens, I'm not a botanist yet, in the middle. And so I'm writing a book about flowers, and I, you know, have been like doing, I'm in like the research stage. I'm just like reading a lot and writing very little. But that was definitely one of those pieces where I was like, I think I have to write about the magnolia now. And then I just started like a rabbit hole of magnolia research. It can definitely be that way, but it can also just be like, I get really sick of myself. So like at a certain point, I'm like, man, we need some outside context in here. And then I'll try to find something to, you know, bolster my argument, if you will, to like use a term from more academic writing.
Please use the title older than bees for this project, because I really like the phrase older than bees.
Older than bees.
Yeah, that's solid to me. So you're going to be a victim now of my morning walk. So when I was walking this morning, I was thinking about style and style as part of substance. And what role does style play for you as a writer and editor, and how are style and substance interrelated? Because I think sometimes style is a dirty word. Mm-hmm. It's people hear that word and think empty flash, but I would disagree. But I'm wondering how you, especially, you know, with that editor side too, how you view style?
So as a writer, I think a lot of times, like, especially people who are first starting to write, are really concerned with style and voice and, like, developing their own. And that was kind of a concern. I don't know. I read, like, so when I was really pretentious, I probably still am, let's be honest, but, like, I was a really pretentious undergrad, and, like, my favorite, you know, writers were, like, Faulkner and James Joyce and all these, like, dead white men who wrote really long sentences. And so I wrote really long sentences because that was, like, the work that I loved. And also, now that you've probably heard me talk, you're like, oh, yeah, of course. And so I've always, I don't know, as a writer, my style has always been the way that I want to write, and then I pull back from there. So for me, like, style is very much a part of the editing process. So as a writer, for me, style is very much part of the editing process. I read aloud. So many times people who, especially if they know me well, will be like, wow, it's like, I can imagine you saying these things. So, you know, for me, it's very voice-based, because that's how I do copy edits. It's like, does it sound good to me when I say these things? As an editor, I actually think style is super important. Unfortunately, like, I've read so many essays that, like, the idea is good, but, like, the execution is just not working for whatever reason. I see that a lot. And I mean, that's just kind of, like, with creative writing, I'm going to regret this maybe. I don't know. I feel like whenever I make blanket statements, I later am like, oh, I can think of so many exceptions to this. But I mean, creative writing is about style, you know, like, style is how you get the thing to the person. You know, thinking about, like, what effect does several short sentences have versus, like, several long sentences? Like, what effect are you creating in a reader? Maybe it's my rhetoric background. I don't know. But for me, like, you can't separate the style of a piece from, like, how it gets the message across, just because I feel like audience is, like, so strongly influenced by, you know, the sentence structure, the syntax, the word choice. It's the same, it's like the ethos, for lack of a better, it's like the ethos is the style of a piece to me.
I guess my thought on it lately too is that I feel like that's the definition of literary. Because that's genres are marketing constructs more than anything. But there is something, like, as a literary writer, there is a type of writing I seek out. And so just trying to define it, I feel like it is that sort of, that thought of the way that the style of writing and that the word choice influences the meaning of the content, that style becomes content in a way. So I don't have good thoughts on it yet. So that's why I asked you, because I wanted some additional opinions.
Yeah, I don't know if I have good thoughts on it either. I have all these, like, ideas floating, and then as I talk, I, like, start to, like, shape them. Is it coming out of my mouth? It's like a balloon animal.
You should write about this. Okay. So could you tell us about your day-to-day writing practice?
Sorry. I don't write every day. I don't want to say I don't believe in it, because, like, I don't write every day. I quit smoking, like, a year ago, and, like, upended my life, and, like, quitting smoking, so I've tried to quit smoking many times, right, like, over the past however many years, and, like, when I quit smoking, I, like, stop writing, like, my brain just doesn't, it needs those little tiny nicotine receptors, so that's been something that, like, absolutely, like, just screws up my writing process. Also, like, you know, life, bills, money, things, the pandemic, things of that nature. And I think for me, like, one of the biggest things is that I have a plan, if that makes any sense. So, like, for instance, I have been, like I said, working on this project, and I'm in, like, the research stage, and it makes me really uncomfortable, if I'm being honest. Like, I feel very unproductive because I'm just, like, flopping about reading books on flowers and, like, ordering things and, like, looking at flowers and thinking about flowers. And, like, nothing is getting put on a page. I'm just thinking about stuff. So I don't feel good about that, but, like, that needs to happen before the hands on the the page can happen for me. Everybody has a different writing process. So like one of my mentors whom I love dearly, like she gets up and she writes for an hour in the morning. And that is what she does. And she writes amazing, beautiful work. I have tried doing that. And honestly, like half the time I just end up staring out the window and not writing at all, which is fine, right? Like just sometimes that's what writing is. It like, oh, what's that movie? There's a show right now about the woman who wrote a book about the Golden State Killer. It's on HBO. There's like, I saw a screenshot from it the other day, but it's like her husband's talking about her. And he says something like, you know, if a writer says that she needs like 5 hours to write, that might, you know, alone, that might mean that she needs 3 hours to like get into the headspace where she can write for those 2 hours. There's just so much like weird shit that happens that we just don't understand, I think, a lot of the time. So my writing process is a bit haphazard and messy, I guess is the short answer to that question.
I think it's very important when authors say that they don't always write every day or there's breaks in their writing, because there was this period, especially when I was starting out, where everyone said, you got to write every day. You got to write every day. And it turns out that that's actually not the real practice of most writers that I know, hugely successful, best-selling, award-winning authors that I know, don't write every day. Mm-hmm. Or they allow themselves to stare out the window for 2 hours. And I think it's really important when the more authors we can have admitting the fact that sometimes there are zero words written in a day. Mm-hmm. I think it's a healthier, you know, if you can do it every day and if that's your thing, I support you and I applaud you. But I think it's also healthier for many of us to recognize that there are slow days or no days at all. Can you tell us a little bit more about this book on flowers that you're writing? The book that will be titled Older Than Bees.
Sure. Yeah, I'd love to. So basically, the way I'm envisioning it right now is, if you've read the crying book, imagine the crying book, except each chapter is a different flower, and it's not about like depression or having a child. It's about like pleasure and relationships. So not just like romantic relationships or sexual relationships, but just like sense, pleasure, and relationships generally. It's still like a very hulky sort of beast. And it's a lot more research heavy than, or at least it incorporates a lot more research than this previous project. I think like integrating research gracefully is like one of the most challenging things to do as a writer. You know, taking like all these, sorry, I'm like gesturing toward the stack of books, you know, taking all these like scientific, technical, just impersonal nonfiction texts, right? And turning them into like something you want to read for fun. No offense to people who read those books for fun. It's been fun. So anyway, that's my book that I'm working on right now about flowers.
You mentioned the crying book. I'm also hearing maybe a little Maggie Nelson-ish kind of something.
Oh, Maggie Nelson, my heart. Yeah. I mean, there's just so many people working well in short forms, you know, and you know, Sarah Manguso, there's so many. Sean Wen, you know, recently wrote this, it was published by Sarah Band, and it's about Marcel Marceau, the mime. You know, there's just really amazing work being written, and short forms are cool.
Right. This is an interesting question. Are you able to write personal essays about recent experiences, or do you find yourself needing more time for reflection?
I need time. I need so much time. Adam. sorry, this is my friend with the beard. I definitely need time. I think one of my mentors used to like make this joke where he was like, don't take too long to write your memoir, Alysia. You're gonna change your mind about the experience. And I was like, oh no. just because like so much of, you know, memory is like a lens through which we look, right? So like thinking about, you know, if you'd asked me what I thought my parents were like when I was 18 versus when I was 25 versus now, you would get, well, I mean, depending on who you were also, but like an honest answer about like my relationship with my parents, you would get really different answers at those different points in my life. Similarly, like just about any relationship, right? Like these, life is constantly moving, life is constantly in flux. And so, you know, part of the artifice of even nonfiction is that, or any sort of art, is that you're taking a thing that's moving and contextualized constantly, and you're, you know, sort of nailing it in place, which is part of like Alysia Washuta, My Body is a Book of Rules. And like a few, I don't know, year, month, some time ago, what is time anymore? But she like came out on Twitter and she was like, I don't have bipolar disorder. And like, that's what her whole memoir was about, or her essay collection. It was about being bipolar. And she's like, I don't have bipolar disorder, as it turns out. Like, sorry if you feel upset by this, but she was misdiagnosed, right? And so it's just like all these things are moving and changing. So I like to be able to at least like confidently say for some period of time that I feel a certain way about something before I sort of nail it in place like a butterfly in my little glass box.
So what is your planning process like, especially for narratives without conventional arcs?
I'm a really visual person. So like, if you've seen that meme from It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, where he's like, let's talk about the mail. That's me pretty much. I heard, what's her name? Jennifer Egan give a talk a few years ago, and she was talking about writing A Visit from the Goon Squad. And she talked about using the mixtape as like a visual working metaphor for herself. And I was like, that's a great idea for me. And so for Fish, the image I sort of used was a kaleidoscope. So, you know, you like look through a tube and you see all this stuff, and then you turn it and you're still looking at the same stuff, but now it looks totally different. And that's how I wanted to approach this, just because like a misdiagnosis of mental, like bipolar misdiagnosis is made up of so many things. Like, it's not just like, it's not the sort of thing where you can be like, I took a blood test and it turns out I'm bipolar, which is partly why mental health is such like a complicated subject. And so talking about it, like that's essentially what I wanted to do, is like, well, if we look at it from this perspective versus if we look at it from that perspective. And I had this like big map, is too generous of a word. But yeah, I would just like, I draw stuff out on like pieces of paper that are quite large, and just kind of like move things around. I've always wanted to do the thing with like a cork board, but I don't have a cork board. But
I was actually just envisioning you like the detective tracking a serial killer with the light. Yes, that's what I was envisioning the whole time.
But I'm the serial killer, like I'm tracking myself.
Wait, doesn't that memento? No, I don't know what's going on here. I feel like that exists. If you have, we might have time for one more question if someone types it in, and I will give one more right now before we wrap up.
Okay.
So I'm interested in how you considered audience while writing these essays. You were writing about a specific topic. How much is this expressing yourself and expressing this experience versus communicating directly with someone who might be struggling with a similar experience?
Yeah. So I think I've been thinking about this so much because I have such a hard time answering this question, because like the question that I want to ask is like, why does anybody write a book? Like, why do we do this to ourselves?
You can do that one if you want to instead.
You know, like what is this like thing inside that's like, you know what I want to do? I want to write a book that I'm not going to get a lot of money for. I'm just going to spend years of my life, you know? And so this is all to say, you know, I think it was mostly a question of capturing what I felt was like the truth of my lived experience. And it was my hope that capturing that messy, complicated truth would enable, maybe, I don't know, maybe perhaps enable other people to capture or better understand their own messy, complicated truths. Because like a big part of my upbringing, so like since I was a kid, I've been a huge reader. My parents were like hippies, and it was just like books and art. And like that shaped my idea of like what mental illness was, is like all the media I interacted with. And I had these like really sort of fixed, rigid ideas about like what mental illness was or was not or should not look like. And just like as I've become an adult, like a lot of my work is like moving away or like teaching myself to unlearn these like very strong binary categories of like you are sick or you are well. Like what is it? Susan Sontag's like illness is metaphor, right? And just so it was about capturing that and hopefully just like making more stuff in the world that like I feel is a better representation of like a worldview that is perhaps useful to people and hopefully like maybe a little enjoyable to read as well.
So my last question then is going to be more of a request, which is please share one piece of craft advice.
Oh, yes.
What is your favorite piece or a important piece of craft advice that you really latch onto?
I think for me, the biggest part about the most important piece about craft is to be patient, which I know doesn't feel like craft advice, but like, I feel like I'm such a context-based person. Like, so every sentence, every character, every title, everything going to depend. And so I tend to resist like absolutes. But for me, like patience is so important. When I first started writing, I felt like I needed to get published immediately. And my work did not get picked up immediately. And it's definitely one of those things where I'm like grateful that some of those pieces did not get published now. And so like learning to teach that patience to myself instead of having editors at random literary journals or agents or whatever, like doing it for me. So for me, that means like being patient with my writing process, like being patient with the submission process, and just taking the time to make something that I'm ultimately happy about versus like, it just needs to get out there. Like if you're freelancing and you're writing for money, that's an entirely different conversation. But like, that's, I don't do this for the money. So for me, you know, I think more about like making something that I'm happy that my name is attached to it, to patience.
What is money? I don't know. And also, we're all gonna get better as writers. I mean, that should be the goal, is that it's one of those things, it's a practice. The thing you write now makes you better at writing the next thing. So I think that is a brilliant piece of craft advice. So it's absolutely craft advice. All right, we're gonna wrap it up there. We will stick around for a few minutes after. So if there's a couple questions I didn't get to directly, and we can address those maybe after the official time has ended here, if you stick around. Just a reminder that you can go to writer.org to see our list of upcoming workshops. Someone sent me a message and asked about our fall workshops. They are not yet on the website. We'll have them up within the next 2 or 3 weeks once we've finalized the schedule. Again, you can find our upcoming events on the Writer Center on the events tab. You can donate money. And I did forget to mention too that we do accept donations specifically for our scholarship funds. If you want to help people take our workshops, you might not be able to otherwise, we love donations to our scholarship fund. That makes us do our mission in every way that we do our mission when that happens. So that's going to be us. Please, please, please buy the book. It is available directly from the publisher or from your favorite local independent bookstore. And thank you so much for being here. This has been fantastic. I loved it, and you're the best.